Thank you very much. So I have to say something about this presentation, because the first time I gave a lecture in an international conference was 30 years ago when I was a PhD student, and it was in the first COMPLUS conference here. So 30 years later, I come back here to give another lecture. I am very pleased of doing this. Okay. So the topic of my talk is just within the framework of this conference to talk about multi-scale model of plasticity, but I will try just to integrate the work within a bigger picture that is really the topic I am interested in. And I am interested in the area of integrated computational materials engineering. I am in between material science and computational mechanics. So my final goal is try to do virtual design of metallic materials and metallic components. So I'll start the talk with a long motivation, and then I will go to some details of virtual testing of polycrystals. What I would just stress the fact that even though computations are very powerful, the coupling of computations and nanomechanics is becoming a very, very useful tool to really to be able to predict the mechanical behavior of structural materials in engineering. I'll try to draw some conclusions. So what is computational materials engineering? Computational materials engineering has a very clear objective. The objective is to do virtual design, virtual processing, and virtual testing of materials in silico, in the computer, before they have been actually manufactured in the lab. And if we achieve that, we are able to do that, we will gain two main benefits. The first one is that, of course, we will accelerate materials development. Even if we design new materials by a trial and error approach, it will be much faster if we do it in the computer than if we're doing with experiments. But the second thing is that we will be able to integrate materials into the design optimization process. So nowadays, you design a new component, you have all these CAD nice tools, and then when you come up with a final size, shape, and performance, you say, okay, I need the materials to build it up. So you go and see on the shelf what are the materials available. We very rarely optimize the materials microstructure for a given application. And this is another benefit. And the strategy to achieve this is simple and complex. To integrate all available modeling tools into a multi-scale strategy capable of simulating processing structure, properties, and performance of engineering materials. That's the set. Now you look at it and see, what is the worst possible scenario for integrated computational materials in engineering? What is the most difficult problem to tackle? And it's not photonics, because in photonics, everything that matters happens at the length scale of the microns. So if you use simulation tools at this length scale, you will be able to solve the problem. It's not electronics, because in electronics, everything that matters happens at the nanometer level. So using DFT, you can solve the problems. And that's the reason why these integrated computational materials engineering studies have been very useful in these areas. The most difficult problem are standard structural metallic materials. And the reason is very simple, because the mechanical properties of cast or wrought metals, the stiffness, the strength, the toughness, the fatigue limit, depend on phenomena that span over 9 orders of magnitude in length scales without talking of time scales. And if you really want to predict the fatigue limit, you have to take into account that depends on the crystal structure, and depends on the size and shape of the precipitates, and of course depends on the porosity, and depends on the grain size, and you have to put all these things together. So putting all these things together is really a challenge. It's something that I guess is going to take us for a long time, thanks God, so we will be able to work. So just thinking and thinking and thinking, I just came up with an idea. Is this the idea? What you have to do if you want to do virtual design in this particular case of cast metallic materials. And this diagram has two parts. The first part on the left is what I call virtual processing. So you begin with the chemical composition of the alloy, and doing DFT molecular dynamics, you get the lattice structure, and then doing cluster expansion and Kitten Monte Carlo, get the phase diagram, and using DFT and transition state theory, you can get the mobility database. And then when you have these two, the Kalfat and Dijkstra kind of information, so you go to your computational fluid dynamics code, fill up the mole, and in each part of the mole, you just look to the temperature, time, history, to the thermal gradient, to the solidification velocity. And with these parameters, this information, and using phase field modeling, you can predict the microstructure. Not only that, if you do heat treatment, you can do see what is the amount of precipitates, the size and shape, the volume fraction, the solute. So you can get a very good picture of the microstructure, what's going on. The second part of the analysis is what I call virtual testing. So again, you just come up here. Imagine that you have are able to know what is the single crystal behavior. If you come up to a mechanical law for this, and you have the crystal structure, you can do computational homogenization, get the effective properties, put the damage model there, get the constitutive equation, and get the mechanical behavior. But of course, getting the constitutive equation of the single crystal is complicated because there are a number of hardening mechanisms that you have to take into account. You have to take into account the lattice resistance, that is anisotropic in the case of HCP materials. You have to take into account solution hardening. And of course, you have to take into account precipitation hardening and strain hardening. And of course, you have to put all these things together. And again, you start for the chemical composition and the lattice structure. And you do using DFT and dislocation dynamics, you can get the lattice resistance or MD. You can get the solution hardening. You have to use also transition state theory. And using dislocation dynamics, you can account for all this and get all these things. So I wrote that up. I submitted to the funding agency. I did decide they were going to give me the money. So that's what I'm doing now. I'm just having fun trying to put all these things together. So, of course, there are many things going on here. And in this lecture, I'm not going to bother you with all of them. Actually, what I'm going to focus my lecture today is in this upper part, assuming that we get this single crystal behavior, how we can go to the actual mechanical behavior of polycrystals. But there are other things that are going on and that will be presented in other talks regarding all these areas that are relevant to multiscale plasticity. So if you want just to study multiscale modeling of precipitation hardening and aluminum copper alloys, basically you start from that and using all these computational thermodynamics, molecular statics, molecular DFT, and phase field modeling, you can predict the size, shape, and volume fraction of the precipitates. And then using dislocation dynamics, you can predict the hardening there from first principles. And this is a talk that we will be doing later on today in the Computational Mesoscale Plasticity Symposium. Will be another two talks going to strain hardening and the Hall patch effect, where basically you have an RBE and the constitutive equation comes from this, all these first principle and dislocation dynamics equations, by you get the effect of grain size. And there will be two talks taking into account and not taking into account strain gradients that we will be giving one today by Dr. Sara Halola, another by Professor Javier Segurado tomorrow in the Metal Plasticity Symposium. And there are more things going on. But let's go to this talk and come back to what I wanted to do. What we want to do is to do virtual testing of engineering alloys. We want to know what is the mechanical behavior of a polycrystal. And in order to get it and get it right, you need two main ingredients. You need to know all the microstructural features. You need to know the grain size, shape, and orientation distributions. And these things can be easily updated today by means of 2D and 3D characterization techniques. You can do serial sectioning, you can do X-ray microtomography, you can do 3D SVSD, you can do X-ray diffraction. And hopefully in the future, we will do multi-scale modeling and we will get these things right from the processing parameters. The other thing that you need, and this is actually the bottleneck nowadays, is the single crystal behavior. You need to know what is the critical result shear stress for each slit system. And if you have twinning for twinning, you have to account for latent hardening and forest hardening. And this information may come from either of these four lines. You can try to do multi-scale modeling. That is what I'm trying to do. It will take some time to get it. You can do data-driven models. Michael promised that this will be solved in 2 years. So hopefully, I hope in 2 years, this will be the way to get this. But then, you can also try to use experiments if these things are not ready, and they are not ready nowadays. You can do mechanical tests of single crystals, but we are talking of single crystals within polycrystals. Or you can try to solve the inverse problem, do the fitting, back up single crystal behavior from tests on polycrystals, either from homogenization or from nanoindentation results. And actually, these two strategies, the mechanical test of single crystals and the inverse problem, are the only ones that are available if you want really to predict the mechanical behavior of very complex engineering alloys. Not talking about just binary alloys, very simple, but really alloys that are used in applications in aerospace, in automotive, for engineering applications. So let's go to it. The first approach is the approach based on single crystal properties from micropillar compression. So you can use this approach, for instance, for the nickel-based superalloy that is INCO 71A. And the basic idea of the approach is very simple. You get the pole figure, and you get the grain size from the experiments, and with this, you build up your representative volume element of the microstructure, where you put all the elements of the grains, grain orientation, grain size, whatever you want to put it. And then you need the properties of the single crystal. How do you get the properties of the single crystals within the polycrystal? Well, you have your EBSD map, and using a focus ion beam, you just mill micropillars and carry out micropillar experiments as a function of a strain rate, temperature, whatever, and make a simple simulation, get the single crystal behavior, put it in here, and then you are able to get the polycrystal behavior. And these techniques that 10 years ago were very, very difficult to do and to get, they are now straightforward and are even being started to be used by industry. So let's go in detail. So the material we are talking, I said, is a nickel-based superalloy. This is the typical structure of the superalloy. You see the grains here. You have some metal carbides. If you go to higher magnification, it's a clean, it's a FCC solution of nickel, where you have some delta at the grain boundaries. What is important, if you go to higher magnification, of course, it's a very strong alloy. If you have a huge volume fraction of precipitates, gamma prime and gamma double prime, it's important here the length scale. So the size of this precipitate is about 20 nanometers. The distance between the precipitates is 20, 30 nanometers. This will be important later on for something I will mention. Then you get to add the single crystal properties. You do micropillar compression. So this is the EBSD map. You can see some twins here. They will be also important here, but the grains with different orientation. You take your milling machine from gallium ions, and then you make these pillars in grains with different orientation. So this is the typical micropillar you get here, and you can be sure that this is a nice micropillar with very little tapering. It's a very, very nice column. And then you put it in your nano indenter, and you just carry out this. So this is just to check that things are going. So you get one grain, and in one grain, with a given orientation, in this particular case, the 111, you just mill two pillars. Or in this grain, with a 001 orientation, you mill another two pillars. You carry out the mechanical test, and you see that you get the same behavior. So these properties are reliable. These points here are dislocation bursts, and when you are talking about these micropillars, sometimes you have these dislocation bursts. The second thing that is important is we are testing very, very small specimens. Are they representative of the bulk behavior or not? And the only way of doing that is by milling specimens of different sizes and sizes and sizes, bigger and bigger, and make the mechanical test and to see whether the critical result shear stress is the same or not. Because if we have a size effect, we cannot use this technique to get the bulk properties, and this is important. So this is what we did. We milled micropillars from 1 micron to 17 microns. This micropillar costs a fortune. And then you carry out the micropillar compression test in micropillars oriented for single slip. You can see the slip bands here. And you can see that in so far you go 3, 4 micron, the critical result shear stress remains constant. And this is critical because what is controlling the strength of this material is the distance between the precipitates. And the distance between the precipitates is of the order of 20, 30, 40 nanometers. We are 5 microns. We are a couple of orders of magnitude higher. So basically, we are getting the bulk properties. So these are the good news for this very complex material. We can get the properties there. And then start to have fun. So you have to use a crystal plasticity model. This is a purely phenomenological crystal plasticity model for the material. So multiplicative decomposition, plastic deformation accommodated by the 12F slip system. This is the plastic slip rate, Gray Lagrange, Payola Kirchhoff, and then the standard stuff, nothing particularly peculiar about that. This is the crystal plasticity model, a power law, elastoviscoplastic solid, where tau alpha is the resolved shear stress on the alpha system, tau alpha c is the critical resolved shear stress, and gamma dot is the shear strain rate. The critical result shear stress in the system that controls the mechanical behavior is given by this law, where H is the hardening modulus that is given by Bose model, and Q, alpha, beta are the latent hardening parameters. So this model relies on a number of parameters. The elastic constants of nickel are well known. And then you have the initial critical result shear stress, the saturation critical result shear stress, the initial and saturation hardening modulus, the latent hardening parameters, and the strain rate sensitivity. And these parameters are obtained from micropillar compression test. So the first thing you get is the strain rate sensitivity. You carry out tests at different strain rates, 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4. Hopefully, in a couple of years, we will be able to go up to the 10 to the 1. There, we're getting there. And of course, there is a small strain rate sensitivity. And basically, it's very simple. You just plot this, and this is the strain rate sensitivity you get at room temperature. It doesn't change much. We can go up to 500 degrees Celsius, and it's limited, but it's there. So you put that value that is there. The second thing you have to do is to fit all the other parameters. And then you have to do the simulation of the micropillar compression test. So this is the finite element mesh of the micropillar. It's a detail. We put the fillet. I mean, we put all the details here. This is the flat punch. We take into account the friction, everything that is there. And, of course, we use this crystal plasticity model in there. And then what we do is a parameter identification of the crystal plasticity model from the micropillar compression test. So these are the values we get of the parameters for the initial critical result shear stress hardening modulus and latent hardening coefficients. And just give you an idea how good is the model. You, for instance, can try to capture the effect of strain rate, and you get more or less for single slip a good job with micropillars, always talking about micropillars of 5 microns in diameter. Then you start to look at what happens when you have micropillars oriented for double slip. And depending whether the double slip is coplanar or non-coplanar, you have a different response in the mechanical behavior, and the model is able to capture that. And just in case that you are not a believer in plasticity, because you know, many people that do simulations have never seen any slip band, not less at this location, just guess it will be nice to you. So this is the typical micropillar oriented for coplanar slip, and you can see here the slip traces. So if you are not a believer, you will see them. And this is the micropillar oriented for planar slip, and then you can see here the other slip traces. So you are able to get this. And then you have the pillar for a multiple slip condition, the 001 direction, and you can see all the slip systems, and you see that the model is able to predict pretty accurately what is the mechanical behavior. Of course, there are some differences. I mean, the shape of the deformed micropillar is nice. Here in the micropillar, we still to have some localization in the slip bands. And of course, the model is viscoplastic, so it's regularized, but it's able to pick up very well. It's not perfect, but pick up well the trends. So with this is the information you have in order to get the micropillar compression, the single crystal behavior. And when you have the single crystal behavior, then the rest is a piece of cake. It's just polycrystal homogenization. So the mechanical behavior of the polycrystal is computed by means of the finite element simulation of the mechanical behavior of RVE, of the microstructure with periodic boundary conditions, nothing else. So what you have to do is to build up the RVE. You get the 2D grain size distribution obtained from 2D micrographs. Because the grains are equiaxed, you can pass from 2D to 3D. This is very simple to do. And then you apply a Monte Carlo model, so you get this grain size distribution, and the grain size distribution you get in your RVE follows the experimental grain size distribution. And then you just assign the texture. In this particular case, the texture was more or less random, so you don't have to do more things about that. So this is, at the end of the day, the finite element model you get. You get a few hundred grains you need to put there, a lot of finite elements to be there, and basically you just apply periodic boundary conditions, and then you have to compare with the experimental data of the polycrystal that, of course, we had then, and to see whether this model that has built up this way, a bottom-up, really has anything to do with the experiments or has nothing to do with the experiments. And these are the results. The experiment of the polycrystalline compression is the continuous line. The simulation curve, I mean, the scatter is very, the RVE is very large. You don't have a lot of scatter there. You get the flow stress, the hardening. There is a slight difference here of about 4 or 5% that they think we have to do with the presence of these annealing twins in the microstructure. that the player role is not very important in the case of monotonic deformation, is much more important in the case of fatigue. That is what we're doing there now. So you can extend this methodology to study fatigue, and of course you have to do things. You have to use much better simulation technique, much faster. So we are now using FFT to do this. So we can simulate many cycles, and you have to put a crystal plasticity model that accounts for kinematic hardening and other things. But this way opens the way for further developments. We can go to high temperature, creep, fatigue, whatever, to do this virtual test. What is the other case? The other case is when this micropillar compression strategy doesn't work. And a typical material in which this micropillar compression strategy doesn't work are magnesium alloys. And the reason is that in magnesium you have twinning. Twinning depends very much on the grain size, and when you are simulating twinning in micropillars, the results you get have nothing to do with the results you get when you have twinning within a polycrystal. The second thing is that in many magnesium alloys, the amount of precipitate is very small, so you need very large pillars, above 10, 15 microns, in order to get bulk properties, and then becomes very expensive. So when micropillar or nanoindentation doesn't work, you can use a different approach. And the different approach is based on you have your RVE of the microstructure, and you put your single crystal plasticity model that has all the physical ingredients, although you do not know the parameters. And then use your favorite simulation technique, either finite elements or FFT, and make a prediction. And you make a prediction of the stress-strain curve, you make a prediction of the pole figure, you make a prediction of the volume fraction of twin material, whatever physical parameter that you can measure, and you just build up an error objective function. And then you just, using machine learning techniques, or whatever technique you want, you do an error minimization, plug it in the new single crystal properties, and you iterate several times until you get the right crystal plasticity problem. And then you can use this technique to simulate other things. So this is what we have done for another example that is another commercial industrial magnesium alloy. Just a little bit of introduction, although I don't think it's not necessary. When you are dealing with magnesium alloys, you have different deformation mechanisms, plastic deformation. You may have basal slip, you may have prismatic slip, you may have pyramidal slip, and of course, you have tensile twinning. These are the typical deformation mechanisms. The critical result, shear stress for basal slip and tensile twinning, are much lower than those for prismatic and pyramidal slip. And tensile twin nucleation depends on the grain boundary. So it's impossible to use micropillar compression, or very difficult using nanomechanics to get these properties. So we have to go for something else. So the first thing you need is you need the appropriate crystal plasticity model. And in this particular case, the crystal plasticity model has to take into account the plastic deformation occurs by slip in three different slip systems, plus twinning. And in the case of twinning, you have a volume fraction of material that is changing, and you have the shear strain associated to twinning that is given in here. And then that when the crystal has rotated and has a new orientation, the material in the rotated part of the crystal can also deform by slip. So you have what is called here re-slip in the twin part of the material. So these are the kinematic equations that are there. And of course, this is the constitutive equation there. Again, it's an elastoviscoplastic solid. Tau I is the result shear stress on the I system. GI is the hardening. This is for the three different slip systems, slip and basal, prismatic and twinning, and pyramidal. And this is for twinning. And here in twinning, you have a volume fraction of material that is changing during the formation. That's what provides the strain. And then you have to take into account the evolution. And when you look at these equations here for the evolution of the hardening, there are three exponents for here, but the saturation stress for slip, twinning, and re-slip, plus the interaction parameters between slip and slip, twinning and twinning, twinning and slip for the latent hardening, and then many other, the initial hardening modulus. So you have a huge number of parameters. If you want to just fit that by a trial and error approach, you will go nowhere. And I'm sure that, actually, this is what people have done in the past, and sometimes you get contradictory results. So this is the RVE of the material with different grains, with different orientation, finite element model, periodic boundary conditions. And then we want to get the critical result shear stress. And for this, we use a very simple but efficient inverse optimization technique. So what you do is use the 11-bar Marquardt method. You build up an error function, and this error function is the difference between your experimental data, that are these points here, and the results of your simulations, where you use a data set of parameters for the model that is given by Vita here. So this is the error function. The objective is you want just to minimize this error function. So in the case of the 11-bar Marquardt method, the objective is to find the set of parameters beta that minimize this error function. And this is done by assuming a small perturbation of the model parameters, linearizing, and you just come up with this expression here that you have to solve, where lambda is a parameter that allows you to go for many local minima to get the really global minima as far as you can use, and J is the Jacobian that has to be computed for each iteration. So in an iteration, you have to make a perturbation, do the finite element simulations for perturbation for all cases. So from the computational viewpoint, this is a huge effort. But, you know, computers are becoming faster and faster and faster, so that can be done. So let's apply this to a typical magnesium alloy. So you have the typical magnesium alloy that was processed by hot rolling. An average grain size of 25 microns. You have the typical rolling texture, it's a basalt texture, that is very, very strong basalt texture. These are the typical rolls of the material. And magnesium is a very anisotropic material. So you can test this material in tension and compression in the normal direction. You can test the material in tension in the rolling direction, and you can test the material at 45 degrees. And when you do a tensile or compressive test, this is what you get. A hugely anisotropic material. When you are doing tension along the ND direction, because of the basal texture, you are activating twinning. So this is the signature of twinning. You have a lot of twinning. While when you are doing compression along the same direction, you only have pyramidal slip that is much harder. So the mechanical behavior of the material is extremely anisotropic. This is a big problem for magnesium for ductility and things like that. So it's important really to understand that. So can we, with this model, predict this behavior? Well, the question is, we should, if we have the right parameters for the critical result shear stress along different orientations. So how do we determine the single crystal properties? There are 12 parameters to be determined. The initial strength, the saturation strength, the initial hardening modulus for basalt, prismatic, pyramidal, and extension twinning. And there are a number of constants that are less important or are given in the literature. So we have to get these 12 parameters. So what we do is we begin with our iteration loop. We begin with the single crystal parameters of pure magnesium that are in the literature and carry out the simulation. And when you carry out the simulation with the parameters of single crystal, this is what you get. Of course, this is magnesium, you can tell, but the results are far off. So you are not getting the properties. So what we do is the inverse optimization. What we did is actually to pick three curves, these two and one of those for the optimization process, and the fourth one just for validation, to be sure that we were getting make some sense. So the predictions with optimized parameters are this one. This is how good the model can do. And because the physics is there, the different mechanisms, you can predict the high anisotropy of magnesium. And with the set of parameters obtained from these simulations, we just go to the fourth direction. And you get something that is reasonable, so you're able to predict that. And then in a further study, we analyze what about the input? So we just found out that you need a minimum of two stress-strain curves, better three, and of course, the texture in order to get better results. And we have seen that the results obtained are independent of the initial values of the critical result shear stress. So we tried with isotropic magnesium, with very anisotropic magnesium, and the optimization methods converge well and is able to give good results. So to summarize, I think that virtual design, virtual processing, and virtual testing of engineering alloys is becoming feasible by means of multi-scale bottom-up approaches. I guess that's the way to go, or one of the ways to go. And the current available approaches, I still have to rely on phenomenological models and experiments. I put you a couple of examples on micropillar compression, inverse optimization, to provide accurate values for engineering alloys components. But I think they will be gradually replaced by rigorous models based on ab initio, atomistic simulations, or, of course, by more sophisticated coupling between different simulation tools, phase field, computational thermodynamics, computational kinetics. And I just want to thank the people who have participated in this work, Professor Javier Segurado and John Molina Aldareguía, and then the former PhD students and postdocs that are now all over the world, and also the funding from the European Research Councils. And thank you for your attention.